nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 116. So now we're going to talk about, extending on the previous lecture, how we can use eigensolvers to do band structure calculations. And before we were saying that the steepest descent method can actually be very effective for so-called convex problems. So let me just explain a little bit more about what is the meaning of convexity in general. So what that means is basically within an open set of values that there's only one optimum. So you don't have like a double or triple peak that are all the same, for example. And then also that the function that you're looking at itself is continuous and twice differentiable. So that means that it's very smooth, doesn't have like really jagged jumps or dips. And then also something that's very critical is that the midpoints are always lower than the edges, and you can express it with this formal mathematical framework, but you can basically see what it looks like using this graph. Okay, so that just means it's kind of like a smooth parabolic type function, right? And so it could be like actual parabola, like x squared, or it could be like a hyperbolic sine function. It doesn't actually matter that much if it's like a very nice function. Of course, not all problems are quite that nicely behaved. So we do have like other methods to deal with those issues. So in some cases, we may need to have like an iterative process to kind of narrow down the values that we're interested in. And so here you can actually see that we have written down two separate formulations for how do we set up and then calculate these problems. And so in the first case, you can see we have defined basically a set of these matrices, which are composites of some of the elementary matrices that we discussed in the last lecture. And you can see that there are basically like two different formulations, which are slightly different from the Black-Rowley minimization that we had earlier. On the left-hand side, it's the so-called Fletcher-Reeves formulation. And then we also have this so-called Pollack-Rabier method. And then in this case, we have subtract this extra G-naught term. So these are actually very similar, except for that one distinction. And both require what's called preconditioning, which allows us to kind of provide initial guess for what kind of results we're going to get. And then this is showing like what the results are for each of these three methods. If we have steepest descent method, you can see that like for the initial iterations, it performs just as well as any of these other methods, but it actually doesn't converge quite as quickly when we get like really close to the answer. However, if we use the Pollack-Rabier or Fletcher-Reeves method, you can see it actually drops like a rock once we get to a certain number of iterations. And so it converges so well at that point that you never need really more than maybe 30 or 40 iterations, whereas you could need hundreds of iterations for the other method if you need a high level of accuracy. So how do we actually get those preconditioner matrices that I was talking about, the K? So there's actually a couple ways to do this. What we're trying to do in practice is make a rough guess at the inverse of the Maxwell operator or eigen operator. And so one method is the so-called diagonal method, in which we just write down that the eigen operator would be dominated by k plus g squared, which is just a very rough simplification of the curl of epsilon inverse of curl operator, by assuming that epsilon inverse is very boring and it acts basically like a identity matrix. However, there's a non-diagonal method as well, which is important for like highly contrasting structures with a lot of periodicity and other interesting behavior. And so then here you would actually project the epsilon inverse and explicitly calculate this A. And so this is kind of showing what happens when you perform the three different calculations. First of all, you can see in red what happens when you have no preconditioner whatsoever. It does start to converge after a number of iterations. It takes a while. In the case of the diagonal preconditioner, which, as you can see, has the advantage of simplicity. It actually already gives you like a much better convergence performance, especially as you get to like tens or 100 iterations. So overall, it's certainly a big improvement, but the transverse projection preconditioner gives us the best overall performance in green. And then there's another type of eigensolver that we can use called Davidson Eigensolver. And then this is where you actually would create a subspace V, which would have the eigenvectors that we care about. So, of course, related to the previous, like Raleigh-Ritz minimization that we talked about earlier, but we also calculated a residual Y, as it's called, which is equal to the product of V and YV. And then we would add that. Oh, sorry, the residual would be BYL minus AY. And then we would add that to V using the D operator. And then if we look at the performance of Davidson compared to conjugate gradient, it turns out that Davidson may kind of break even with conjugate gradient at small number of iterations, but at the end of the day, it doesn't actually converge that much better. There is like kind of maybe a small window where it looks like a little better around 10 to 20 iterations, but overall we won't end up using that because it's not as big of a benefit. And then the next lecture, we'll talk a little more about the details of how do we do this calculation.